Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. Why don't we go ahead and get right into it? Let's stand and praise our God this morning.
Sing it out, shout it aloud. Cover all the earth. Let the sound of the saints everywhere be heard. Praise the God who has come to cure every broken heart.
The God of brilliant lights is shining over us.
This next song I know we've done before, but if you know it or if you don't, let this be your prayer this morning. It's called Here's My Heart. And let this be a prayer to open up your heart, open up your soul to what God is saying to you. Not just to go through the motions or hear the words, but let Him speak so deep into your soul that your life changes forever. Invite Him in with this song. Let it be your prayer. Here's my heart.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. 'Cause I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life. speak what is true.
That is our prayer, God. That here we are. This is who we are. And we're grateful, Lord, that you know us better than we know ourselves. So we come, we pray with humility, with a recognition that we don't deserve to give you our lives. Our lives are such a mess. But by your grace, by your power, you take broken lives like ours and you redeem us and you renew us. We pray, God, this time of worship pleases your heart, but also changes us some more, that you take what we give you, and God, you make something out of it that we could never make on our own. For your glory always, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. All right, real quick, before she gets away. Last Sunday, I mentioned that we had a baptism Wednesday night at Fusion. We were baptizing a student who was in Fusion as part of our church. He's actually helping lead you in worship this morning. Brandy was baptized on Wednesday, so. It was awesome. I got to hear her testimony. Mary Fugate baptized her, her small group leader. Got to hear Mary's testimony. It was an awesome night, and I was glad to be there, to be a part of it, be a small part of it. And I'm so encouraged by a number of you that showed up in support as well. That's awesome, and thank you. And God is doing some awesome things, and it's cool to just be a little bit in a part of that. So anyway, also, I guess, welcome again. My name's Doug Betts. And I am the children and youth pastor here, and we're glad you're here. I'm excited that you're here this morning, and for whatever reason, God brought you here, so welcome. Thank you for being here. Just a few things that I want to share in addition to the baptism. It's got me kind of fired up a bit, but we had an annual vision sharing meeting last Sunday as well, and I will say, I don't know what they're typically like, but I left the meeting very encouraged and inspired at what God is doing within this church, and in particular within you guys, and how he is just really working through you. So anyway, for me, it was an awesome meeting, and I'm excited about what the future holds. So a few other things just to mention. We are starting divorce care and divorce care for kids. That will be on Monday nights from 6:30 to 8 o'clock, and that will begin on February 5th and ends on April 30th. A reminder for our meals ministry. Tracy Anders is leading that, and that again is just a ministry that is provided for individuals who have had a hospital stay or, you know, some other illness or difficulty in their life that has made it a bit of a challenge to do some things where we can just provide meals for them to help them out. And what a great service that is to provide, you know, Christ's love and help with a meal. Also a reminder that tonight, Boost Ministries has their praise and worship night tonight at the First United Methodist Church. That's at 7 o'clock tonight. In addition, our young adult small group that meets on Sunday nights, usually over here, we're going to be going to the Boost Praise and Worship Night as well. So don't go to the house, go to the First United Methodist Church. And then this week, Clash will start on Wednesday. It's our first Clash of this session. So if you haven't got your kiddos signed up, there are sign-up sheets out at the Welcome Center. We also have an online version, and you can find that located. The link is in the bulletin, as are a lot of other things. And then for Fusion this week, we're going to tackle, this is a big question, I know, but it's, why are we here? And we're going to look at it from a couple different angles. One, you know, why are we here? How did that all get started? The Bible tells us, gives a great heads up to how that all got started. But we're going to tackle that question. And then also, you know, what is the purpose behind why we are here? So a couple big things we're going to look at this week at Fusion. And then finally, Kids Church. Oh, wait, nope. I had a note that I wrote down in between services. If you're on the stewardship committee, there is a meeting right after this service in the library. So if you're on that committee, be sure to be there. And then finally, Kids Church, which happens during this service. So this is for kids kindergarten through fourth grade. If you guys want to come up here, and we'll head out in a second. You don't have to come up here, but if you want to, that would be awesome. This morning, we're in the book of Acts, and we're going to talk about a time when Peter, the apostle, he is called by the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel to a Gentile. And so this is somebody that Jewish people typically look down on. And this allows Peter and lets us know that the gospel, the truth of Jesus, wasn't just meant for certain people. God wants everybody to know the truth of his son Jesus. So we're going to talk about that today. All right. Thank you.
Hey, good morning, church. Great to have you out today. I'm going to lead us in our prayer time here, and so you can be thinking of any prayer requests or praises that you'd like to share with us. To kind of prime our hearts and our minds, I want to read a couple of verses from the book of Daniel. Daniel had been in a tough situation where he and other advisors to the king were all going to be killed because the king had a dream. And he wanted people to interpret the dream, but he didn't want to tell anybody what the dream was. And God supernaturally gave the dream and the interpretation to Daniel. And after that, he's filled with gratitude, of course, but he prays these couple of verses here, Daniel 2. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells with him. And one of the things for me with that text, just as an encouragement when we come to God in prayer, is that it points out two pretty important factors, characteristics of our God that we pray to, and that is that God knows. God has a knowledge of the deep things, the hidden things even, so that when we come to God in prayer, it's very personal. God knows each one of you here today. We're grateful for each one of you here today, but God knows you by name. He knows the number of hairs on your head. He knows the thoughts, the deepest thoughts in your mind and in your heart that you maybe have not shared with anybody. But God knows you, and he loves you. So his knowledge on the one hand, so that when we come, you can have every confidence that God understands. He knows what you're going through. But more than that for me, his knowledge, and these verses bring it out, his knowledge is matched with his power so that he can do something about it. It's great to have the comfort of somebody with you, but a lot of times we lack the power to be able to change circumstances or people. We don't have that kind of power, but God brings great love and great power so that he works always for our good. I don't always understand how he does that, but I know that God continually tells us for our good. And so what you were singing just a little while ago, he is good, he is. And that's our confidence in coming to God in prayer. He knows and he has power to work in every aspect of our lives. So we have some things that were shared from the first service that I'll incorporate into our prayer time. But if you have anything to add to that this morning, just raise your hand and we'll be happy to hear any request or testimony, something that God has been doing in your life. We'd love to hear that as well. Yeah. And tell me again who? Don Strody? Okay. Don't get freaked out when I come down because I can't hear you, but that's just my hearing, not your problem. But we want to make sure we pray for Don Strody, bypass surgery. We will ask for God to be at work there to bring help and healing. Someone else who have anything to share? Yeah. We'll pray for your uncle. And what's his name? Jerry. So a cancer diagnosis, but then they're going to do some more tests to see if it's spread. We're going to pray that God will be with him and that, in his mercy, that it would be healed, that God would bring some help there. Someone else had a hand, I thought. Yeah.
Can you say that again? I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. So that's a great praise. Leela's doing better. So we'll pray for Charlie Bach, who just went into the nursing home, you said?
Into Hilltop. And then a praise for Leela, healing that she got from her cold. Okay, great. Yeah, Corey's our son-in-law's grandmother was diagnosed with breast cancer, and so we want to, if you would pray for our family with that, that would be great. And then also our son-in-law and our daughter, they're moving, but they don't have jobs, so it's a step of faith here for them. And you know that I don't worry about that, right? pray for us for that. That would be great. I got a prayer request for that, that Paul Winkle passed away, and we'll definitely be praying for him. And I'm sorry, what else did you say? For Eileen. Eileen took a fall. Some of you know Eileen, and she took a very bad fall the other day, so we want to pray for her healing as well. Good. Any other requests or praise? Yeah. Name again, what was it? Melvern Cornett. That he passed away last night. This is the week. We'll pray for God's blessing, that things go well there. Pastor Dave writes much faster than I can write up here. He hears better and he writes faster. Other prayer requests or praises that you'd like to share? Thank you. It's an encouragement to the body. I know it's not always easy to share some of these requests because they're painful, they're struggles, but this is a good chance to do that together. So we mention them out loud, not only so that I can pray through them here together with you, but that you can carry them with you throughout the week, and I encourage you to do that. So let's take these to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, who's in heaven, but you are also near and close to us. We give you praise this day, God. Your name is great and awesome. You have created all things. You are good. You provide for us. You sustain us. You redeem us. And you do all of these things, God, often without us asking. You are just so good that you provide anyway. But we praise you for all of your good acts towards us, for your sustaining power. We're especially glad, Lord, to know that your name means that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever, so we can count on you. May your name be great among us. May we carry your name with joy and integrity so that the whole world may know you. Lord, we give thanks again that even though you dwell in heaven, you are close to those who are in need always, close to the brokenhearted. And so we come to you, God, as a needy people. We pray, Lord, as we think about these requests, though, we pray for them in the context of your kingdom. We pray that your kingdom would come, that your will would be done. We all know what our wills are, Lord. We know what we want. But we want what you desire for us. So may your kingdom come in us, Lord. May your will be done in each one of us. Help us to be the change that we want to see all around us. Help it to start with us. So we surrender ourselves again to you. A prayer of surrender, submission to you.
in trust that this is what we were made for. So not to you, not to us, Lord, but to you be the glory. We also know that you've called us to pray for daily bread. So give us this day our daily bread, Lord. So these requests that we have, Lord, we pray for Brian Thorne, who was in an accident and needs healing. We give thanks for a testimony that someone offered about the power of prayer and to see answers to specific prayers. We give you thanks with them. We pray, Lord, for a friend of Susan Graben who has had a long-running fever, a very high fever, and we pray for healing and relief from pain for them. Bring them wholeness. Lord, we pray for Eddie Yeager, who was in a feedlot accident, and we don't know his condition, but we pray, God, that you would bring healing and encouragement there. Support him and those who care and love for him now. Lord, we pray for Jessica, who is going to have a double mastectomy tomorrow. And you know the situation and the fears that would accompany all of that, the dread of what that might bring. But we pray for you to be at work through doctors and nurses. Bring healing and encouragement through them, we pray. Lord, we pray along with Sally Williams for a sister-in-law who needs peace and comfort. You promise that you can give us a peace that even goes beyond what we can understand. Would you bring that for her? Lord, we pray for Don Strody, who's going to have bypass surgery. Lord, we pray for Jerry, who's got a cancer diagnosis, and we pray that you would be good, and we ask for a really good diagnosis, God, one that's treatable, one that you would be at work to bring healing. We pray for Charlie Bauck as he's in the nursing home now, and the transition and the struggle that can happen with that. We pray for Leela. Lord, thank you that you were gracious and merciful and have brought healing and strength, new strength for her, a great answer to prayer. Lord, we pray for Corey's grandmother, the breast cancer that she has. We ask for your grace to fill her life, to sustain her. We ask for help and healing for her and for Corey and Abby as they move and look for a job. Lord, you're the great provider. We ask that you provide for them. Lord, we pray for those who are grieving the loss of Paul Winkle, who passed away suddenly this week. We ask God for your grace there that brings a healing to hearts that are hurting. God, a grief that is matched with hope. God, we pray for Eileen Bean, who took a bad fall. For Melvin Cornett, Lord, we pray also for Matt and Chelsea that this will be a blessed week. You would bring great strength and joy with a new life. God, thank you. You're so good to bless us in so many ways. So we have these and lots more needs, God. We are a needy people, but this is good for us to ask that we don't rely on ourselves, that we trust you. We pray that every one of these requests, you help us throughout the week to continue to pray without ceasing. God, we also would take some time to pray that you would forgive us, because every one of us here has sinned again. And as we ask you to forgive our sins, Lord, we're drawn to the truth of your Son, his atoning blood and sacrifice, and you tell us that all sins may be forgiven through Jesus Christ. And so we ask you, God, help us to be specific in our minds and our hearts right now. Not just a feeling that we're kind of crummy, lousy sinners, but specific areas where we turned away from you, where we didn't trust you, where we treasured something else more than loving our neighbors, where, God, we got caught up again in cycles and patterns of habits and routines and addictions. God, forgive us. This is not what we were made for. and we need your help. But God, as we receive your forgiveness, which comes freely and readily through Christ, then would you remind us right now of others who have sinned against us? Because we want to take this moment, God, where we receive freely your forgiveness, and we want to freely give forgiveness to those that right now we're angry with, those with whom we're bitter, those who have caused us pain, and there's a part of our hearts, God, that wants to get revenge. God, give us your forgiveness so we can forgive them now. And I would pray, God, even if it's someone in this very room, that this was an appointment that you made, that we would be in worship together, that we would not leave this place without going to them and making peace with them. And this would all be to your glory. And then, Lord, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil, because we know there's a spiritual war going on right now. We know that our enemy, the devil, likes to prowl around and roar, and he would like to bring fear into our lives, but we thank you that you are greater and that you're living in us by your Holy Spirit. And so greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. Thank you, God. Deliver us by your unmatched power. And God, as we see victories happen, we pray that we come to understand this truth, that we're more than conquerors because it's your victory. It's your power. It's your grace. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now's the time of our service where we celebrate communion. We would ask that everyone who's accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, that they would participate in communion with us today. We just ask that you would hold the bread and the juice until everyone is served, and we will take communion together. Our reading this morning is from Malachi 1:8. When you bring blind animals for sacrifice, is that not wrong? When you sacrifice crippled or diseased animals, is that not wrong? Try offering them to your governor. Will he be pleased with you? Would he accept you? Says the Lord Almighty. When God sent Jesus to die for the sins of all mankind, he sacrificed the very best that he had in heaven. God didn't send some low-level angel from the outskirts of heaven down to take care of your and my sin. He sent his only begotten Son. In return, God expects the very best from each one of us. He expects us to willfully and joyfully turn over the entirety of our lives to him and then let it be used in his service. He wants our talents, our creativity, our time, and all of our resources. Unfortunately, the tendency for us humans is to hold back the very best that we have and give God what's left over. In Malachi's day, this involved sacrificing blemished or defective animals to God instead of taking the best that they had in their herds. The Jewish people at that time, in that way, didn't worship God, and they didn't believe that he deserved their very best. So as we think about this in the new year, I would challenge each of us to not be complacent, lukewarm Christians, but to really present God with the entirety of our lives and to let him guide us daily and really to commit all of our talents and resources to his use. If we do this, we will please God, and in this way we'll impact ourselves, our families, our communities, our church, and our world. So let us joyfully give the best we have to God.
At the feet cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of your mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy.
From the Gospel of Luke, it says, and he took bread, gave thanks and broke, and he gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Offering scripture is Malachi 3:10, which says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessings for you that you will not have enough room for it. So why does God ask us to give a tithe to the church? Is it because he needs our money so he can get things done? I really don't think so. I think God has all that he needs without us giving him anything. He really owns everything in the earth. And in the Bible, it says he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. So why is it that God asks us to give? Giving is not for my benefit. It's for my benefit and not for God's benefit. Otherwise, if I don't give, that my heart's selfish. I'd only think about myself. And I want to keep everything for myself and not be generous and look for the needs of others. It says, one pastor I listened to said that my checkbook will tell you the priorities of my life much more accurately than my words. So where did I spend my money last month? Was it all for my benefit, or did I use it to meet the needs of others? I would ask that each one of us just examine our lives and make generosity a priority as we go throughout our days. Let us pray. Dear God, we just ask that you would help us to have a generous spirit that looks to benefit others. Help us to resist being selfish and thinking only of our own needs, but help us to look around us and really truly look for people that need our help. And that I would just ask that you would help us to be generous every day, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Everybody falls sometimes. You gotta find the strength to rise up from the ashes to make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now. Sun will soon be shining. You gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. And I've seen miracles just happen, silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new. That's what faith can do. It doesn't matter what you've heard, impossible is not a word, it's just a reason for someone not to try. Everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water, but it'll be alright. Life's so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that does.
Thank you, praise team, and good morning again, church. It's good to have you here. I do want to get right to our message for this morning. So if you have a Bible, you can find it helpful, I think, to follow along. Exodus, the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 16 through 22. We will have it on the screen here, so you can follow up here as well. We are in a series here in Exodus, working our way through, looking how God takes and frees his people who are slaves in Egypt, his people Israel, the Hebrews, and he's going to free them from slavery, and how that gives us a pattern for the way that God works in our lives to free us as well. We see this over and over in Scripture, but this is a clear pattern of God's salvation, how he brings us into freedom. So we've been looking at this, and we're kind of in the middle of something here in chapter 3, starting in verse 16. We're at the burning bush. We were at the burning bush last week. We're going to be at the burning bush this week, and you're going to still be at the burning bush next week. So it's going to take us a while. There's a lot that happens there. Moses is, God reveals himself to Moses through this burning bush. And as they have this kind of ongoing conversation, we're going to read today just kind of a part where God speaks, where he reveals his plan. He opens up to Moses his plan and what he's about to do. So let me read this. Follow along. Remember, this is God's word. "Go, assemble the elders of Israel and say to them, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me and said, I have watched over you and have seen what has been done to you in Egypt, and I have promised to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, a land flowing with milk and honey. The elders of Israel will listen to you. Then you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt and say to him, The Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a 3-day journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. And so I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. And after that, he will let you go. And I will make the Egyptians favorably disposed toward this people, so that when you leave, you will not go empty-handed. Every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman living in her house for articles of silver and gold and for clothing, which you will put on your sons and daughters. And so you will plunder the Egyptians.'" Let's take a moment to pray. Father, help us. We confess our need for your Holy Spirit to teach us, to speak so that we can hear the thoughts in our minds and the attitudes of our hearts. God, we pray that you take control of them and speak to us so that we can be changed and we can live the way that you call us to. We're grateful that it's on your heart already to do this. So we pray with confidence in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to come at our text today kind of indirectly, okay? And I'm going to start us with a verse from somewhere else. It's always great when I read a passage and then I start us off somewhere else. Jeremiah has a verse that we're going to look at, but it's going to raise to the surface here for us a question about a phrase. There are certain phrases that you hear a lot, and sometimes people think they're biblical. They're not always biblical. You know, if you ever hear "to thine own self be true," a lot of people are like, "Oh, that's in the Bible somewhere." No, it's from Shakespeare. It's from Hamlet. Some people say, "Well, beggars can't be choosers." That's got to be in the Bible, can it? No, it came from the Middle Ages. Some mom who got frustrated with her kids, they wouldn't eat what she put in front of them, and so she came up with that. God helps those who help themselves. Ever hear that one? That's not in the Bible either. It actually comes, no kidding, it comes from an old Arab proverb that says, "Trust in God, but tie your camel," which was the whole idea that you're supposed to do something. We need that in our house somewhere. Trust in God, but tie your camel. It comes from this idea that, oh, well, there's a part that you do. Now, the Bible does speak about some of these things in kind of a way that you can say, well, I could see some of that. Like Philippians 2, if you say, well, God helps those who help themselves. Philippians 2 says, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you." So God does some work. We're supposed to work with him. So if you take some of these phrases, they're fine as long as you take some time to pick them apart and say, what's the real truth here? Because some of these catchy phrases miss the mark if we just hold on to the phrase itself. The phrase today that I want to look at that I think has to do with our text in Exodus, and also as I'm going to point it out here in Jeremiah, is if you've ever heard this, God has a plan for your life. Ever heard that phrase? You know, I think you can make a pretty strong case. Well, that is in the Bible, almost directly in one sense, Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And like, well, there it is. God has a plan for your life. I mentioned that God is giving Moses his plan. He's telling Moses in Exodus 3, this is his plan. But when you and I think of that phrase, God has a plan for your life, we have to pick that apart a little bit, because I think if we don't, we will take our best ideas of what that could be, and it could actually twist the truth of what the scriptures say about God having a plan for our life. So let me just mention a few things that scripture says regarding God's plan for our life. A lot of times people think, God has a plan for my life, which means that every possible decision that I have in my life, there's a right answer and there's a wrong answer. So I'm faced with many decisions when I wake up in the morning. Not least of them is Fruit Loops or Raisin Bran. You know, which one of those is it going to be? And some people can say, if God has a plan for my life, then it's got to be crystal clear that it's one or the other. Now that one's too easy. We all know that Raisin Bran is from the devil, so we know that Fruit Loops is the way to go with that. But a lot of times we just think, well, if he's got the plan, that means every step I'm either making a right step or a wrong step, because we think of it so narrowly. But I would want to argue that scripture, when it talks about God's plan for your life, gives a great deal of freedom within God's plan. Don't get me wrong. You want to pray about everything. You want to ask God, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to respond in everything? But a lot of times the scriptures show us that God says you have multiple choices and options, and any one of them can still be within God's plan for your life. And I would say, you know, as we think, well, you know, cereal, that's kind of trivial. But Cliff, the big decisions, that's got to be where God always has just one thing here. But I would point out, and then we don't have time to really look at it, but you can look at it later. One of the big decisions that people always, you know, wrestle with, at least we did in college. You get to college and you're like, everything's a big decision, you know. What's my major going to be? What job am I going to get? Where am I going to live? Who am I going to marry? I mean, these were all the questions every Bible study I was ever in college that had something to do with that. God's plan, what am I going to do? And so when you think, well, it's got to be something specific there. But the interesting thing is in the Bible, the one chapter in the Bible where it goes extensively into marriage, which are like, well, gosh, that's got to be, you know, the one. I mean, Cliff, don't get unromantic here, right? I mean, Laura's the one. She's the one in God's plan. I believe this is God's plan for me, that we're married. But I would say in 1 Corinthians 7, God tells us very specifically through Paul that God gives a lot of freedom here. Paul's talking to people who are contemplating, should I get married, should I get married, not. I've been kind of dating this person on and off. But it feels like maybe I should be obligated to get married. And Paul addresses that in 1 Corinthians 7. Look at it when you have a chance. But in there you read stuff like, if the person who feels he ought to marry, he should go ahead and get married. He should do as he wants to, it says. And the one who's made up his mind not to marry, this person also does the right thing. And then he goes even further. He says, you're actually free to marry anyone you wish, but they must belong to the Lord. And so what this says is, even with a huge life decision, God is saying, look, I'm giving you some freedom, but I'm also giving you some boundaries. And the boundary when it comes to marriage for a believer is that the person that you're going to marry has to be a believer. And there's all kinds of reasons, I can't get into it right now, why God says there's a huge reason why, and it has to do with your hearts either growing closer and closer together as you grow closer to Christ, or further apart if you have divided first loves. And so he says, though, you're free to marry anybody. You would expect of any chapter that would be the place where Paul says, now look, this is a huge life decision, and there's only one right choice, so you better get it right, you know, God's plan for your life. There's this breadth of freedom where God says, yeah, you can choose whatever cereal that you really want to eat, you know. But if you're trying to be heart healthy, God recommends the oatmeal probably more than the other cereals. So God is saying there's freedom within my plan that you can choose and still be in the plan that I have for you. That's one thing. You're like, well, that makes it sound like God doesn't care. It's not that God doesn't care. Think of it this way. If I go to Hobby Lobby with my wife, I haven't mentioned it for weeks, so it's okay to mention this. I go to Hobby Lobby, and we go into Hobby Lobby, and Laura is looking at the knickknacks, and then she's looking at the fake floral place, and then she's looking at the fabric, and then she's looking at the picture frames, and she's looking at the art supplies, and yes, I have this memorized, the whole store. There's a lot more I could go to, but she goes to these things, and she says to me, hey, look, I'm looking at these things, what do you think? And she pulls out two things, and she's like, well, do you like this one or this one? You know, I feel like I'm at the dentist when they're doing the, does this look better or does this look better? They look exactly the same to me. I don't know that. I said, I'm fine with that. No, really, I want to get your thoughts on it. I said, well, look, just no purple, no kitten prints. Can we just no kitten prints? And other than that, I'm good. We're good. And then she'll say, well, how much can I spend? I'm feeling really generous that day. I'm thinking, you know, $5 or $6. Can you spend $5 or $6? And then she gives me that look, and I'm like, I mean, on each thing, you can add all that up if you want. At some point, what I'm saying is, look, my will, my plan, I know that I'm putting myself in God, so I'll pay for this later, but my will has certain parameters. You can spend up to this much. I don't really care for this. I don't like that. But within that, you are free. God gives you freedom in his plan to make all kinds of choices. And you're like, why would God do that? Because he loves us. He says, I made you to be free. I made you not to be robots that just do exactly what I press a button to do, but to have creativity and freedom. And there's a freedom within God's plan. So don't think of God's plan for your life so rigidly that you get so, I think, paralyzed by fear. Because you're like, oh gosh, I think I got out of his plan. I made a bad decision here. Lots of freedom there within his boundaries. Within his boundaries. And that's important because our hearts would take God's plan for our life and we would manipulate every circumstance we want so that it looks like it's okay, like it's God's plan. I get God's stamp of approval on it if I can just say, well, the circumstances kind of tell me that it must be God's plan for me. And we will, our hearts, because we have sin in them, will twist and distort every kind of thing to make it look like it's what God wants when it's really just what I want. So, you know, I mean, I pray this prayer almost every day. Lord, I want to be in your plan, in your will today. So I need to know, God, is it in your plan for me to go to Dairy Queen? So if it is, then just make that one spot right in front of the door there at Dairy Queen, let parking spot open when I come up there. Because if it's open, then I'll assume that that's your way of telling me that's part of your plan for my life. And sure enough, the eighth time around the drive-thru, there it is. It's the open spot. And so I take that. So we know our hearts would do this with everything. Oh my goodness, God must want me to do this because the circumstances. Don't get me wrong. God speaks through circumstances. He absolutely does. But recognize that our hearts would take everything and try to twist it. And so we always pray, not my will, your will, God. I know what I want, but what's your plan? And then also notice this, and this gets us back to our text. The context. Jeremiah says, I know the plans I have for you. I know some of you here, it's your life verse. Like, you love that verse. And it's a fantastic verse, isn't it? But most of us would take that to look at as, well, then God has this plan that's really about me. And what I want to argue this morning from our text is that God does have a plan for your life. But the plan for your life is never disconnected from God's greater plan. Never. God is not interested in giving us a little personal plan that's all full of comfort and ease and the things that we want in our life, our personal preferences. What he's saying is, your plan, you were made for this. Your plan is connected to my greater plan. And that has huge implications for us. Jeremiah 29:11 is a great verse. I have great plans for you, plans for good. But do you know what happens? Do you know what is before Jeremiah 29:11? Smart aleck will say Jeremiah 29:10. Right? Verses 4 through 10 of Jeremiah 29, are basically, here's the context. Notice the context. The context is Jeremiah is a prophet. The people of Israel have just been conquered, and they have been exiled out of their homeland where they have always lived, the land that God gave us, and they've been exiled out, carried out by a conquering army to a foreign land, to Babylon, where now they are going to live, because that's what conquering peoples did. This is how Daniel and his buddies get taken out. Some of the best and brightest, they take them and they incorporate them into their culture, their society. They want the best of the best. They yank them out. And some people in Israel were saying, I wonder how long we're going to have to be in Babylon. And false prophets began rising up in Israel saying, hey, don't worry about it. It's not going to be very long. I know we lost here. I know that we've been defeated, but God is going to rise up and he's going to bring us back here, and it will not be very long at all. False prophets. And God sends the prophet Jeremiah to tell them this. It's going to be 70 years. You are going to be exiled for 70 years. And when you get to Babylon, settle down. Marry. Have children. Have grandchildren. Build your homes and your businesses. Bless the very people who have conquered and persecuted you. Pray for their peace. Lift them up, because if you're a blessing, the whole city's going to be blessed. If they're blessed, you're going to be blessed. God says, settle down, because it's going to be 70 years there. And then God says, I'll bring you back. Now that sounds fantastic, right? But I want you to think very particularly here. Imagine if you are a 40 or 50 year old Israelite and you've just been told Jeremiah 29:11, God has a plan for your life. What's the plan? 70 years. You're telling me I'm going to die in Babylon. That's Jeremiah 29:11. Most of the people who are hearing that are not going to outlive the 70 years. They're going to have to live out the rest of their days in Babylon. And our individualistic culture that we live in, most of the time would hear something like this and say, why do they even care if God's going to bring them back after 70 years? I'm already dead. Because God is saying, my plan for your life is necessarily connected to a greater plan. And if you don't see that, you won't actually become the person I want you to be. Because here's the deal. Why is it important that people hear now, 70 years? Why couldn't God just wait and then say, okay, now it's time, I'm going to bring you guys back, because that other generation, they probably died out by now. He tells them because why? They have to raise their kids to the promise. They have to raise their grandchildren to the promise. They have to say to their kids, you know what, I'm probably never going to make it back to Israel. Not in my lifetime, but you will. And I want you to know this promise. I want you to hold this promise, because that is God's plan for your life. And it's connected to God's plan for my life. I have to live it out here in Babylon, but I get to raise you to know the promise. And here's the joy of this, is this bigger plan that God has, is that we get to say, does it work? It does. We know it because if you read in your Bible, Ezra and Nehemiah and Esther, these are people who are raised with the promise, even though the ones telling them the promise will never see it in their own lifetime. And here's the question for us then when it comes to God's plan. Are you seeing the greater plan? When we say God has a plan for your life, he does. But you and I have to connect it to the bigger one, because Moses is in the same boat. Did you catch when God begins to tell Moses the plan? He says, I'm going to bring you guys out of your misery. I'm going to free you. Moses is going to experience it. But he also says, and I'm going to bring you into a land flowing with milk and honey, the promised land. And guess what? Here's your first Sunday school quiz number one. Does Moses ever get into the promised land? No, he does not. God is giving him a plan for his life. And Moses could argue, well, I'm not even going to get to get in the promised land. He doesn't know that yet, but it's coming. He's like, so how's that part of my, because he says, if you can see your part connected to the bigger, that's the key. So here's quick things here from our text that also help us to understand God's plan for our lives in the bigger context of his plan. And the first is this: God has chosen, we can argue with him on this, but God has chosen to work his plan through witnesses. He tells Moses in verse 16, go assemble the elders of Israel, say to them, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, appeared to me. Tell them that I have appeared to you. Now, if you're Moses, you could argue, this is a really bad plan because, God, you could do this way better than me, way better. In fact, if you would just make this burning bush thing happen for the elders, I wouldn't even have to talk to them. They can just have their own experience with you, and God insists on saying, no, you go tell them that I have appeared to you. You be my, what's a witness? A witness is somebody who has seen or heard something. In a legal setting, if you have seen an accident or if you have witnessed a crime, they drag you into court because they say, this person saw or experienced it, and they are a witness to what happened. And then they talk with you. They ask you, what did you see? What did you experience? Now, it always strikes me as funny because they also have in court, you ever hear this? Expert witnesses. You ever hear that? Expert witnesses. And most of the time, we're going to argue with God about, you want to use me as a witness in your bigger plan, but I am not an expert witness. Do you know what an expert witness is? Someone who didn't see at all what happened. An expert witness is somebody who comes in. Did you see what happened? No, I didn't see at all. Well, why are you here? Well, I'm an expert witness because I can tell you about this or that that might be related to it, but ultimately, it's not about them. It's about the real witness, who usually is what? Shaking with fear up there. Just tell us what you saw. And here's where we want to say, but if God realized that I just cannot do that, he would come up with another. His plan is to use you as a witness. I don't really go golfing, but I went golfing the other day. I have an old ball and a new ball, and I'm on a hole where there's water, and I have a magnet to, you know, my balls are going to head for the water. So I didn't want to use a new ball, so I put an old ball down, and I got up there, I got ready to go, and before I swing, boom, voice from heaven. God says, Cliff, Lord, use the new ball. It's hard to argue with God. Take the old ball out. All right. This is good. God's going to do a miracle here. I'm going to go ahead and put my new ball down. This is going to be a great shot. And before I get that, boom, voice from God says, Cliff, take a practice swing. That's a good idea, Lord. Really good. So I step back. I take my very best practice swing. I step up to address the ball again. And before I can swing, another voice from heaven, God says, Cliff, use the old ball. And that's kind of the way that we look at it. We think, I'll bet you God in his mind is saying, I know I'm asking all of you to be witnesses, but you are thinking right now that God has in the back of his mind, but they really can't do it. And I'm really worried about using them because they can't pull this off. God never, ever has doubted his ability to use you. And it's not about a technique. It's not about being an expert witness. It's about what? Telling people what you've experienced. Have you experienced, in some form or another, the goodness of God? Then tell somebody. Share it. It's no more than the man who was born blind in John chapter 9. He's born blind. Jesus comes along, heals this man. He's a full-grown adult now. For the first time ever, he gets to see. And he probably wishes maybe the first sight he didn't see were Pharisees gnashing their teeth at him saying, who healed you? What happened here? This guy came along, this Jesus. We know that Jesus isn't from God. And then they start throwing all kinds of theological stuff at him. We know it's not this. And we're experts in the law here. We know all this. And at the end, this guy, he's actually on trial. And at the end, he testifies. He witnesses. He says, look, I got to be honest. You're raising a lot of questions that I don't know the answer to. But then he has the great line, but this much I know. I used to be blind, and now I see. That's what it means to be a witness. You're not trying to come up with a technique, some process of coming up with what I have to say. It's simply sharing what God has done for you, and don't ever minimize what God has done for you. It's not a miracle. It's always a miracle. There's never something that God hasn't done for you that's not a miracle, that God, the holy God, would work good in your life. Share it with others. That's his plan. Here's the other thing, though. We participate, but only God changes hearts. Some of you worry about witnessing or sharing what God has done for you because you think, yeah, but it's not going to change their life. You know, they're not going to believe me. They're not going to. Notice what happens with Moses. Moses, go to the elders, and God tells him, they're going to listen to you.
but then Pharaoh won't listen to you. And then he doesn't actually throw this in, but later on the elders won't really believe him anymore either. And it's going to be all over the map how people respond. And God in his plan says, don't worry about that. I'm calling you to testify, to be a witness for me. Don't worry about how people respond, because here's the key, you can't change their heart anyway. So it actually is meant to free us. If you and I stop trying to be God for a day, where we control people's lives and control the way they respond, and just be freed from that and say, just witness, just share what I've done. But God, they might not believe. Yeah, that's right. Moses, they may not believe you. Pharaoh for sure won't. But I'm not sending you because I'm counting on you to create the results. Only I can change a heart. And by the way, when you share, despite the results, and I know it's scary, but this changes you. You share it because God uses it as he's going to change a heart or even harden a heart, if that's where they're at. Let God change the heart, but know that every time that you share, you are not the same afterwards. I cannot tell you how many times somebody has told me, and you might, some of you are like, well, that's not a big step. Somebody will say, Cliff, you know, there's a prayer time, and I raised my hand for the first time, and I shared something that was going on in my life, and that was a huge deal. Because Cliff, I'm not good in front of people, I'm a little nervous, I don't like to do that, but I did it. And I'm telling you, they're not the same after they've done that. People, when they join the church, the worst thing we make them do is they have to come down front here, you know, we make them stand in front of all you, and nobody likes to do that. Everybody hates it. And so they're like, ah, oh, I join, except I really don't want to do that. And then when the person finally reaches, they say, I'm going to do it anyway. And they face that fear and they do it. And in one sense, they basically become a witness, because I ask you, are you a follower of Christ? Have you received Christ? Yes, I have. That's a public confession of faith. You witness. You are not the same after you face that fear and take that one step. It happens with baptism. I can't tell you how many times I've baptized people back here, and afterwards they've said, and I knew they were, you don't see it, but their knees are shaking in the water. The water is just kind of moving all over because they are just afraid. And I know it. And I know it's because not only am I making you get up in front of people, but you're going to do it in your skivvies back here. You know, you got hardly anything on. It's like, this is the most embarrassing thing, but you do it anyway. And I'm telling you, some people come out of that, they are not the same. Some people have said to me, I was so nervous, I thought I was going to throw up. And I was like, well, that's not the worst place to throw up if you got to do that, right? But I know that I'm looking in their eyes and I'm like, you are not the same person because you took this step and you didn't worry about the response. Let God change the hearts. And then lastly this, in God's plan, this is the hard one for me. He gives the promise, but not all the details. I wish he gave more details, or maybe I don't. Do you really want to know all of the details? I think I do, but I'm not sure I do. God says, I have promised, here's the promise, to bring you up out of your misery in Egypt. I've promised to free. That's the promise. But there's a whole lot that happens between then, where we're at now, to that freedom. A whole lot that happens. And God gives some of the details, but not all of it. I mean, God says, go tell the elders, you know, and then go tell Pharaoh. And he's not going to listen to you. Okay, we got that detail, but we didn't get the detail that Pharaoh would not only not believe, he would get so ticked off, he would make their life more miserable. Fine. Bricks without straw. You want to go free? I'm not going to let you free. You're crazy. And now you've got to make your life even harder so that Moses in his mind would come, and he will, he'll struggle with this. He'll come back and say, God, I know you said Pharaoh wouldn't believe, but you never said that he would make life harder, that the first step toward freedom would be worse. Things got worse before they got better. How can that be part of your plan? See, that's the question that we ask, because we didn't get that detail. Or Moses might say, well, you said the people would be for me, you know, that they would believe me, the elders would believe me, but it won't take more than another chapter or so before the elders will turn and say, you didn't hear from God. Who do you think you are? God, you never told me that in the plan that I would be ridiculed, that my whole idea of my testimony would be undermined because people just don't believe, and how that would hurt and how that would make me doubt. How can that be a part of your plan? Or God, you gave me this great sign because I get worried about, well, they really won't believe, and you say, take the staff, you know, throw the thing down, it'll become a snake. It'll be a great sign. And God, I thought, that's fantastic. I finally have a visual that I can take to him. And so when we get into that place where Pharaoh won't believe, and I say, Aaron, do the snake thing with the rod. Throw it down there. This is going to wow him. He throws it down, becomes a snake. But God, you never said that they were going to be able to do the same thing. And suddenly they're throwing two of them down. And suddenly it's like, well, that blows my whole deal right there, God. How can that be a part of your plan when the very sign that you give makes me look like a fraud? How can that be part of it? God, you said you'd set us free from Egypt, but you never said that we were going to have to face our greatest fear, that after you freed us, we would have our backs literally against the Red Sea. And my greatest fear is that God would start freeing me and it wouldn't last, and that I would die. And God, how can that be a part of your plan, to have to face that kind of fear? And we wrestle with God because we say, I hear the promise, I know the promise, but it's the details. And God is saying to us over and over and over in his plan, he says, hang on to the promise and do not let the details diminish or degrade the promise ever, because the details will change. The details always change, but hang on to the promise, because there is a God who can take even the worst painful details and work them by his plan towards his promise. The greatest story I've ever heard about this, I love this one. This is from a pastor. His name is Philip Griffin. He had a church plant in Texas. And he said as they were a new church, they had a lot of new believers that were coming. So they wanted to do baptisms, but they were renting space. They didn't have a church building. He said, so for baptisms, we decided we were going to get a pool. We brought a pool in outside the church, outside where we were meeting, and we would just fill it with water. We would do the baptisms after the service. We'd have our service, and then we'd go do the baptisms. He said, so we had this plan. We had a number of people who were going to get baptized. He said, but as I came in, he said, you're running around getting ready for service. As he said, I realized right before I get up to preach that I had forgotten to bring a hose to be able to fill the pool with water. And he said, so it's on my mind. He said, I'm preaching, but I'm also thinking, I got to get, as soon as the service is over, I got to make my way out. I got to go get a hose. I got to go buy a hose somewhere, get a hose. He says, so I'm thinking that whole time. If he says, I finished preaching. And of course, I'm trying to greet people, but I'm trying to get my way out. And of course, it always happens this way. A guy comes up to me. I've never seen him before. He said his name is John. And John comes up to the pastor and he says, I need to ask you a question. And pastor's like, you know, I'm thinking, I didn't tell him, but I got to go get this hose, but I got to listen to this guy. He says, I need to ask you one question. Are you guys for real? And he said, what do you mean by that? And he said, well, I need to know if you're for real. He said, I need you to know that I'm a person. I struggle with homosexual desires. He says, I have my whole life. And he says, I believe actually what you preached earlier, that God loves us, but he doesn't love everything that we do. And I believe what you say in the Bible, that it's not right, it's not God's will, but I'm losing that fight. I've been in and out of multiple gay relationships, and I struggle with that. And he said, and I went to another church one time, and I opened up about that, and I shared it with them. And they wanted absolutely nothing to do with me. He said, so I need to know, are you guys for real or not? Pastor said, you know what? We're trying to be for real. God's at work in us, and I want you to know that doesn't scare us, what you just told me. And he said, and they sat down, and they began to talk about, there's a ministry that they wanted to connect him with. And then he saw one of the small group leaders for a men's group, and he says, I want you to get to know the small group leader. He says, these guys are going to love on you. And they're not scared off by what you're saying either. And he said, we began to talk about this, and it was this great moment. He said, and so he says, we're wrapping this up. I start thinking, I got to go get this hose still. He said, and John says, but I got one more thing I got to share. He's like, what is it? He said, I also got to tell you something else. He said, I didn't plan on being here today. He said, I actually had planned out my suicide this morning. He said, what I did was, he said, I decided I was going to kill myself because I've been battling this and I've been in despair about it. He said, but I decided, I went to the store. I got a hose and I got some duct tape. And he said, I was going to drive down this dirt road, kind of deserted, and find an empty spot. And I was going to tape that in to my exhaust pipe. And I was going to kill myself in this secluded spot. He said, but on the way down this road, there's your church. He said, I just thought I'd come in. And now I feel like maybe there's some hope. And the pastor said, John, you bought a hose. Yeah. He said, and what we did was we used that hose to fill up for baptisms, new life. And he said, we've used that hose at all of our baptisms because it's become this great symbol, something that was meant for death, a detail that is part of the mess that we gets us towards the promise. We're like, how can that be part of God's plan and his plan for my life? And God will take the very thing that's meant for death and redeem it for life. That's our God who has a plan for your life and mine, but it's always connected. Our joy is always connected to his greater plan. Let's pray. Lord, help us to believe it. Help us to know your presence right here, right now. That this is real for us. That there are details, that's too small a word for some of the pain and struggle that many are experiencing. And it's clouding our view of the promise. You said that you would free us. You said that you would be with us, that you would never leave us or forsake us, God. So help us to hold to the promise and never let these details tear away at what we know to be true. But we need your help. We need your strength of your Holy Spirit. So move among us right now, God. Reestablish the truth of who you are among us here so that we can be free in your plan. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Worship God. Listen for the Holy Spirit. If you feel prompted to pray, we're available right back here at the doors. Come out while people are singing, and we would love to pray with you about any need you have. Otherwise, let's stand. He's worthy of our praise. Let's sing to him.
My life has led me down the road that's so uncertain. Now I'm left alone and I am broken. Trying to find my way, trying to find the faith that's gone. This time I know that you are holding all the answers. I'm tired of losing hope and taking chances on roads that never seem to be the ones that bring me home. Give me a revelation, show me what to do. 'Cause I've been trying to find my way, I haven't got a clue. Tell me, should I stay here, or do I need to move? Give me a revelation, got nothing without you. Got nothing without you. My life led me down this path that's ever winding. Through every twist and turn, I'm always finding that I am lost again. Tell me when this road will ever end. Give me a revelation. Show me what to do, 'cause I've been trying to find my way, I haven't got a clue. Tell me, should I stay here, do I need to move? Give me a revelation, got nothing without you. I don't know where I can turn,